So welcome to our course, a two-day short course on node-level performance engineering. We hope we have enough material to keep you satisfied over the 2 days. The agenda for the course is on the web, on the CSCS website. We'll not stick 100% to this agenda. We'll also be flexible, depending on what prior knowledge you have. And so first of all, if you want to know or want to get the slides that we show here today and tomorrow, there's a URL here. And if you click on that, you will see the following website, which is more or less empty right now. We're not displaying all the slides beforehand, but we will display them as we go. So especially for the first set of slides, we have a quiz in the beginning. We don't want you to see the slides for the quiz before, including the solutions. So I will display the slides when we are beyond the quiz, of course. And they will appear here. And you will be able to download them, and they will stay there for, I don't know, at least months. So there will be some more opportunity to download them. Okay. So first of all, in order to know what you know, and what kind of prior knowledge we're dealing with, we have a little quiz, and I ask you to answer those questions to the best of your knowledge. Probably many people know some of the topics we're going to cover here today and tomorrow. And if that's the case, we can adapt a little bit to your needs. Okay. First question, what is a write allocate? It's also called a read for ownership. Who knows what that is? Write allocate. Has something to do with processors, caches, computer architecture.
Who of you has a computer architecture background?
No computer architects. Very good. Very good. So write allocate. It has something to do with how data travels from memory to the CPU and back. OK? Nobody knows about write allocate. That's very good. Because if that's the case, well, we're telling you something new now. So the answer is, if you have a cache in a processor, so a cache is a small memory that stores data which is hopefully often needed and soon needed again, then you have the situation from time to time that if you want to store something to memory, for example, a result from a computation, you need to store it back into memory, but the processor can only communicate with a cache. So what has to happen is that the cache line in which this data item resides must go from memory to the cache first. Although you're storing something, something must go from memory to the cache first. So you do a store, but you get a read. That's the effect of a store miss. And this is called write allocate. Okay? We will see that this is important to know, because it's important to calculate the data traffic incurred by certain programming constructs. If you don't know about the write allocate, you underestimate the required data transfers. That's why it's important. We will cover all of these more in detail if you don't really know what we are talking about. What's Amdahl's law? Who knows Amdahl's law? You don't have to be a computer scientist or computer architect to know about Amdahl's law. It's applicable to all sorts of processes all across all sciences. So can you give a short two-sentence description? Exactly. Okay. So it's a general, a very simple, actually very simple performance model, a theoretical performance model for the speed up we get when putting more resources into some kind of work. This work, usually in scientific computing, is doing some flops, doing some useful work, solving an equation system, whatever. And we make the simple assumption that some of this work is easily, perfectly parallelizable, and some of this work is not. It's not parallelizable. And the fraction of work which is not parallelizable, we call S. It's between 0 and 1. Hopefully, it's close to 0, but it could also be quite large, close to 1. And now the speed up we get from a parallel computation, or any kind of parallel work, is the time we take for executing this work with one worker, one CPU, one construction line worker, whatever, divided by the time we take for executing this work with n workers. That's the speed up. That's how much faster we can do, we can finish the work. And if you do the math, you see that if you assume that a fraction of s of the work cannot be parallelized, this is the speed up you get. 1 divided by s plus 1 minus s over n. And you see immediately, if you increase n to very large values, then this term in the denominator vanishes, and you end up with 1 over s. In other words, if you have a serial fraction, a fraction of your work that can't be parallelized, which is probably only 1%, which doesn't sound too large, and you put in 1,000 workers, then the speedup is still only 100. If you put in 10,000 workers, the speedup is a little larger, a little closer to 100, but it's still almost 100. That's why it's also called the law of diminishing returns. The more effort you put into accelerating one part of your work, be it by accelerating the computation, putting more resources on, putting more processes on, no matter what, the more effort you put into the parallelization, the less return you get. Diminishing returns. That's all about Amdahl's law. And you see immediately that it's not only applicable to parallel computation, it's applicable to all sorts of parallel work. What is the roofline model? Does anybody know what the roofline model is? Roofline. It's been called that way since 2008 only. It's been around for at least 20 years, 25 years. It hasn't been called roofline before. So the first reference we got was from 1988. Some people call it the balance model, machine balance, code balance. Any of these terms known to anybody of you? No? Also very good. The roofline model assumes that there are two principal bottlenecks for the speed, for the performance of a computation. Either you're limited by the performance, by the speed by which the processor units can crunch the data, so doing flops, doing actual computation, the thing that we're interested in. So that may be one limit, which is good, because you're at the limit of the computation capabilities of the machine. Or the other limit, you are limited by the data transfer capabilities of your machine. How fast can I transfer data from memory to the CPU and back? Because if I want to crunch data, if I want to do flops with data, I need to have this data in the CPU. If the data path to the memory is a bottleneck, I can't get my full performance. And the roofline model describes that. It's actually a very simple model, very simple assumptions, but extremely powerful, as we will see. And there's a graphical representation. There's a metric called computational intensity, how many flops can you do for every byte that you transfer from memory. And it predicts the performance in gigaflops per second. It's usually applied on a loop-by-loop level. Many scientific codes are based on loops. We look at that loop by loop. We make this analysis for every loop, and we get a prediction for the performance for every loop. You'll see that this is extremely useful, and it works in many cases. OK, continued. How many cycles does a double precision add, or double precision multiply, or double precision divide take on a modern processor, your average workstation laptop processor? What do you think? How many cycles, how many compute cycles? So we have 3 gigahertz, so 3 billion cycles per second. How many of those cycles does it take to do a double precision add, adding two double precision numbers? How many? No, it's a little bit too optimistic. One. Sorry? 3 for the add. That's correct for the modern Intel processor. An add takes 3 cycles. The good thing is we can do another add every cycle. So if you have enough adds that are independent, you can get one result every cycle. But a single add from end to end takes 3 cycles. Multiply, any guesses? Same, roughly. It's a little bit slower, 5 cycles. Multiply takes 5 cycles. And divide? 20, very good. So 20 is 22. It's true for the Sandy Bridge processor. On Ivy Bridge, they've improved a little bit, so it takes only 14, I think. So it's quite expensive compared to an add and a multiply. So it's good to know these numbers to also make performance estimates for simple loops. Yeah. If you use the old 80-bit floating point stack, I mean, nobody uses that anymore. There's a reason for that. So modern compilers don't use this facility anymore. If you just use a modern compiler, like Intel compiler, also modern GNU compilers, for more than 10 years, they don't generate code for the old floating point units anymore. So they're dead, essentially. Because the layout of this hardware is so bad for things like pipelining and superscalarity, it's just a bad design. And everybody uses the SSE facilities. OK, so 3 cycles, 5 cycles, 22 cycles on an Intel Sandy Bridge processor. And it's similar for other modern designs. Who knows the stream benchmarks? Stream. They've been introduced in the mid-90s by McAlpin, Dr. Bandwidth, still writing a very interesting blog. If you Google him, it's very nice to read. The stream benchmarks are the de facto standard in high-performance computing for measuring memory bandwidth. It's a very simple benchmark, 4 simple kernels. They give you a bandwidth number in megabytes per second, the maximum rate at which the CPU can transfer data to and from memory. This is very interesting because it's one of the major inputs, as you will see, for performance modeling of loops. You need to know this number. And the motivation for doing such a benchmark in the 90s was the realization that people saw that the CPU speed, the rate at which CPUs could compute, grows at a much larger rate than the speed by which data could be transferred from memory, so the bandwidth. And the stream benchmarks reflect that. You can have a track over 20 years of the highest performance of the processors and the highest bandwidth, and you see that the slope of the bandwidth curve is lower than the slope of the speed curve. You see that here. It's not that bad, actually. It's a little bit exaggerated, but the trend is there. And stream gives you a metric to measure that. What is SIMD vectorization? Who knows SIMD? SIMD, S-I-M-D. It's one of the variants in Flynn's taxonomy. Who knows Flynn's taxonomy? Yeah, you know, okay? So what's SIMD? What is SIMD? What does it stand for? S-I-M-D? Exactly. So it's single instruction, multiple data. All modern processors have this. But it's not a new idea by all means. Yeah? SIMD has been introduced decades ago. So it's really an old concept. The way we have it today is much inferior to the way we had it 40 years ago. We can say that. But we still have it. So single instruction, multiple data means we have data parallel execution units. We can apply an operation like an addition, not only to two operands, left and right of the plus sign, we can apply it to many pairs of operands at the same time. So in other words, modern processor doesn't only have one add unit, it has, for example, 4 double precision add units, and we can kick off an addition for 4 pairs of operands with a single instruction. Single instruction, multiple data. And we'll see in detail what the consequences of this are, in which situations you can get more performance out of a CPU by using SIMD. It's one of the major driving forces behind peak performance today. What is CCNUMA? Who knows CCNUMA? What does it stand for? So NUMA means non-uniform memory access. Okay. What does the CC stand for? Cache coherence. Okay. So non-uniform memory access means we have a system like this. This is the architecture. We will see more of this later. This is the architecture of a typical compute node, 2 sockets. Each socket has, in this case, 6 cores. Today we have 8, 12, probably 15. Each socket has its own memory interface and its own memory attached. So the memory in the system, although it's a shared memory system, is physically distributed. We have one memory portion on the left socket and one memory portion on the right socket. But it's still shared memory, so every core in this system, every processor core, can access all the memory. And there's some magic in the hardware that makes this possible. The downside is, if the memory you need is over here, and the program that you run to use that memory is over here in the left socket, then you lose some performance because your data has to travel through this memory interface over this data path between the sockets to the left CPU. And that's inevitably slower than if you had the memory here in your local domain. And we will see what the consequences are and how you can work around this problem. You should always try to avoid the situation. You should try to place the memory in a place where the CPU that runs the data, that crunches the data, actually is located. Okay, so we're set. I think we have a good impression of what your prior knowledge is, and I think the course is really laid out well in relation to your prior knowledge. Okay, so I now hand over to Gerhard, and he will give you the introduction. Oops, sorry.
Okay, so can you hear me? Okay, good morning and welcome also from my side. You may wonder, why are we talking 2 days about node level performance? The node level performance, who considers node level performance important? Nowadays, the machines have hundreds to 10,000s of nodes. So we should have scalable codes. And node level performance, this has been done 20 years ago. And as Georg mentioned, most of the features at the core and node level, they are known also for 20, 30 years, like CC-NUMA, like SIMD vectorization. So why not look at scalability? Scalability is the major issue today. So many people assume this basic assumption, so that in a world of highly parallel computer architectures, only scalable codes will survive. So if performance is not enough, and if I've got a scalable code, I just go to a bigger machine, or I ask my computing center, I need a machine twice as large. The computing center is happy because he has a good customer and a good scientist who gives me a good reason to apply for more money for a bigger machine. So everybody is happy. And of course, why take care about single core performance? On a modern chip, we have 8, 10, 12 of cores. In a big machine, we have a million of cores. The core design is old. Caches are known for a long time. So why should we even look at that? Because we have so many of them. So this is a nice example what we mean with scalability and single core, single node performance. So this is a simple stencil update, 7-point stencil, which might arise from a 2D, from a 3D finite difference discretization of Poisson equation and doing a simple Jacobi step, or this kind of updates often show up in smoothing steps of multigrid algorithm. So who has never seen a code like that? This is Fortran, by the way. So who has never seen a Fortran code before? So don't be shy. Okay, who has never seen a stencil code before? Okay. Oh, so you're well prepared. So I run the two versions of this code on a single socket of a Sandy Bridge processor with core, so very similar to the processor which is used in the big Cray machine here. So I've got 8 cores, and I show or I measure speed up as a function of cores. Because if we've got want to have a scalable code, we need to have a good speed up. So the best thing we can do is to get a speed up of n on n cores. So if we assume 8 cores, so we should get a speed up of 8 on 8 cores. And you can see the black code. This is a scalable code. And remember, this is only 8 cores. The big machine here, how many cores has the big machine here? Olaf, you know? How many? So which of those two code versions is better prepared for your big machine? Any idea? So obvious, this one. So I am prepared for the highly parallel era because I get 8 times more performance if I run on 8 core instead of 1 core. However, getting scalable code is really simple. Just switch off optimization. So the difference between the two codes is just switching off any optimization on the black one and using highest optimization on the red one. So one important lecture of this tutorial is to understand this feature and to get an idea what happens here. So by the way, you can make a proof that running a slower code on a given machine always scales better than any other code. But this may take 15 minutes to explain. Okay, so you can prove that. Reducing code speed gives you a better scaling code. What is the problem here? What don't we see here? Pardon me? We don't plot performance, because this is only speed up. We don't know what is the performance of the single worker, of the single core. So single core performance, if you assume single core performance doesn't count, you will show this graph. If you feel that single core performance is important, you will show this graph. So here, the scenario changes. The non-scalable version gives much better performance because of higher single core performance, while the black one scales very well still, but at a much different level in terms of performance than the red one. So now you might argue, okay, I've got 8 cores here. Next generation machine in 5 years will have 64 cores on a socket. Then I will pass this code. Who feels that this is true? Who can tell me what is the maximum performance of this code on this machine? Because this is the basic question we address in this chapter. Any idea? So this is really simple, and here we can use the roofline model. We will show that later on. With a simple roofline model, we can prove that for this given code implementation, this is the maximum performance on this machine. And this is the complete lecture or tutorial is about the question, what is the maximum performance I can get for a given code on a given architecture? And to answer this question, we need to know about the code, about the application, and we need to know about the hardware architecture. And the first thing is always to determine what is the current bottleneck in the hardware which prevents me from getting faster. Any idea what is the bottleneck of this code if those dimensions are big, like 400, so I have a 400 cube problem? So this is the first point. Which bottleneck in hardware limits my performance? So why is the limit here? So who knows the bottleneck? Yes, memory bandwidth, because all cores access the memory interface, and this is our bottleneck. So if we know the performance of the bottleneck, if we know the pressure of the code on the bottleneck, we can easily estimate what is the performance of our limiting of our code with respect to the limiting hardware bottleneck. On the other hand, you can see what is the bottleneck here. Here we have a different bottleneck because we never hit this bottleneck in hardware. In this case, the bottleneck is single core execution. The single core execution is too slow to expose enough pressure to the memory interface that we even reach this bottleneck. And understanding this, we can easily estimate if you put 80 cores here, you will end up at this level, because then you have enough cores which have enough pressure to the memory interface to hit this limiting bottleneck. Okay, so this is like a summary of that what I said. The questions we want to ask here are, do I understand the performance behavior of my code, like in this simple example? So can I establish a performance model? This is our performance model, assuming one bottleneck. And does the performance of my code match the model? For example, if I assume the bottleneck is this one, and I see I cannot hit the bottleneck here, I know my assumption is wrong. So there's some limit, room for performance optimization here, because this is my bottleneck. This is a word from Georg Kager, and I feel this is a very important word. Remember, high-performance computing, performance, is always computing at a bottleneck. So performance is a good term, and bottleneck a bad term. So you connect a good term with a bad term. But this is, your performance is always limited by a bottleneck. And detecting this bottleneck and finding ways to reduce the pressure on this bottleneck is always an important step in code optimization. Because if you don't know the bottleneck, you don't know which optimization or code changes to apply to get better performance. Okay. So, and often, or sometimes, I have a nice model, I have a good code implementation, but in worst case, the performance is better than the model. So you have to rethink maybe the model. So did I estimate the correct bottleneck in my model? Or maybe I did get some hardware inputs, for example, in my model wrong. And we will have some examples on that. OK. So, as you have seen on this simple example, we need to understand performance to detect the bottleneck and set the baseline for any optimization. We also need to understand the hardware. So what are typical bottlenecks at hardware, and how does hardware work, so that we can set up something like a machine model for our performance model? So and in the next 30 to 40 minutes, I will try to step through the most important bottlenecks in hardware which we consider. So this is like a computer architecture 101 lecture in 30 minutes. But we concentrate only on the relevant bottlenecks and briefly explain how those features basically work. So I think everybody knows that we are in the multi-core era and there's no way back. We face two important trends. First of all, we get more and more cores with each generation of processors. So from Sandy Bridge to Ivy Bridge, Intel has added two more cores or three or four more cores. And the second one, this is good news, so we get more and more parallelism, more and more performance. And a second trend is that, in best case, the clock speed of those cores stays constant. Often, clock speed slightly decreases over time. And this is good. This is bad news. Because performance through clock speed is free for the programmer. Performance through parallelism is not for free. You have to exploit parallelism to the compiler to generate a parallel code. So, and those are the basic trends. I will briefly step through them. Who has never heard about Moore's law? So good, Moore's law, everybody knows. By the way, it's not a law or a theorem, it's more projection. In 1965, Gordon Moore, who was a co-founder of Intel, claimed that the number of transistors on a microchip at the economical sweet spot doubles every 12 to 24 months. So this was basically not about clock speed, which later on was Moore's law was translated to clock speed. It was about the number of transistors at economical sweet spot, and economical sweet spot means price at constant price. Everybody knows that the average price of an average equipped PC did not increase or change over the last 10, 15 years. So this is basically Moore's law, but performance increased. And here, this is really a surprise that over more than 40 years, we see this exponential increase in transistor density. So this is the number of transistors on various processor chips over time. And we started in the early 70s, we have a few thousand, and now we are at several billion transistors. So, and the good news is that Moore's law is expected to continue at least in the midterm, 5 to 7 years, something like that. So we will get more and more transistors at the same price. More transistors means more execution unit, more caches, so more performance in total. For a long time, Moore's law directly translated to faster clock speed, because if you have more transistors on the same chip space, you need to make the transistor smaller. If you have a smaller device, you can switch the device faster. So this was the basic idea, that you could directly translate the smaller device sizes into faster clock speeds. But at the same time, the increasing amount of transistors allowed for many for the implementation of several interesting ideas on the hardware level, because I have many transistors to do them. So here are five hardware features which have been implemented since the early 70s and which we will cover briefly in this introduction, because they are often some kind of a performance limiting factor, or they contribute a lot to the maximum performance on the processor. The first one is pipelining. So we need pipelining to go to those high clock speeds. Pipelining is inevitable on those processors. We see a trend. Who knows? Pipelining is important. Who has never heard about pipelining on processors? So we will have two slides on that, because some code structures prevent from pipelining, and you will get a big hit in performance from that. Superscalarity. Superscalarity means that a modern processor is inherently a parallel processor. It executes multiple instructions at the same time. So I have instruction-level parallelism on the processor, and to do so, we need parallel execution units, like multiple floating point units, multiple load store units, which run in parallel and which cost transistors. Then we have SIMD, which Georg already mentioned. We have multi-cores and multi-threading. And we have very complex large caches, which often help. But in terms of performance modeling and detecting bottlenecks, we need to understand basically how those caches work. OK, I skipped this slide. The message from here is that it's much easier for the computer manufacturer to double the performance of a chip by reducing the clock speed by 20% than to increase the overall clock speed by 20%. So the problem here is that in some ranges of clock speed, the power consumption scales with the cube of the clock speed itself. That means if you increase clock speed by 20%, power consumption increases by 70%. However, if you reduce clock speed by 20%, power consumption reduces by a factor of 2. That means within the original budget, you can now host twice the amount of transistors, but all of them running 20% less than the original speed. And this is basically what Intel and those processor vendors play. For example, GPUs. GPUs host a large number of transistors, 7 billion. But the price to be paid for that is that they run at 700 megahertz. OK, so this is the overview of the Intel-Xeon Sandy Bridge architecture, which is used in the machine here. The base clock here of this processor is 2.7 gigahertz, and it can dynamically overclock up to 3.2 gigahertz. With simultaneous multithreading activated, each processor chip will report itself at a 16-way machine. I will say a few words about SMT in a few slides. This processor has 2.3 billion transistors, and the structure size is 32 nanometer. It's always very impressive to remember the size of the chip is the size of your thumbnail, 2 by 2 centimeters. So the big cooling equipment doesn't by any means give you an idea what is the size of the chip. The size of the chip is only 2 by 2 centimeter, but it generates so much heat that you need a cooling equipment of this size above the chip. And all modern processors, compute nodes come in this CC NUMA fashion, at least on the x86 side. Who knows a machine, a supercomputer, which is not a CC NUMA architecture, which is not of this size, which has not 2 or 4 processor chips in a node? BlueChain Q, yes? BlueChain Q. What is the processor architecture, computer architecture in your laptop? Is it CC NUMA? Who votes for CC NUMA? Who votes for something different? Who says, I don't have a parallel processor in my device? It's a UMA, unified memory architecture. Because if you omit this part here, this is what you have in your iPhone, in your laptop. You have a multi-core processor where multiple cores have a single memory controller. And this means uniform memory access machine. You have a flat memory, only a single memory instance for all processor cores. So this is a very, very rough view how most processors are designed, or all modern processors are designed. So the most important components, and we have only shown those components which we talk about, basically. Basically, you have a processor chip and the main memory. On all modern architectures, the processor chip hosts the memory interface, which does data pull in and pull out data from main memory to the processor and back. And this memory interface is connected to a last level cache. Here we have just used a level 2 cache. This is a single core processor, by the way. So we have a last level cache here, L2 cache. Then we have an innermost cache, like an L1 cache. And this L1 cache is not connected to the execution unit. All modern machines are registered to register machines. So the execution units, like floating point multiply, floating point add, and also the integer execution units, they only work on operands which are in the registers. And they put their output operands to the registers, their result. So we need additional hardware units, like the load store units, to bring in the data to the registers before they are used. So this is important to understand what happens on the core level. We modern architectures, they separate execution from data transfers. So we have separate load store units, which are connected to the level 1 cache only, which bring in the data to the register file, and then we execute instructions on the data in the register file. This is a typical sign of the so-called RISC architectures, reduced instruction set computing architecture. Who knows an architecture which basically does not need this feature, where you have combined instructions. And you should say, so we have instructions which work here and instructions which work here. So we separate on the instruction level the data access from the operations itself. This was CISC. In CISC, you could do with a single instruction, load two operands, perform the operation, and store back the result. This was a single assembly instruction. If you would need to do it here, you would have to do two loads to load the two operands, do something like a multiply, and then store back the result. So you would have four instructions instead of one, because we have separated this path, separated the data transfer from the execution. So we will not talk about any integer operations. There are many integer execution units on the processor, but they are of minor importance in most floating point and oriented numerical simulation. On the cache level, we have a separate instruction cache and a separate L1 cache typically on all machines, while L2 and higher level caches, they hold both instructions and data. But we will only focus on the data caches here. This is a very simplified picture. So we haven't shown most of the control units, like instruction fetch, decode, like branch prediction, out of order execution, and things like that. But this is a coarse view we need to know about to understand later on, for example, how assembly language looks like. So let's now step through those five hardware features I mentioned: pipelining, superscalarity, SIMD, SMT, and caches, which means data transfer. So one important step to get to higher clock speed was the pipelining of the functional unit, because it soon became clear that a floating point multiply cannot be performed in a single cycle at 3 gigahertz, because all the wiring would be far too complex. Who knows? So floating point multiply is a basic operation. You agree? Who knows how to split up a basic operation like a floating point multiply into several steps? Any idea? Pardon me? But yes, but how to split up a floating multiply operation into what are the steps of a floating point multiply operation? Who knows about floating point data format? So we have three, any 64 or 32 bit floating point data has three information decoded: the sign, 1 bit, the mantissa, and the exponent. And here we start, so that we have to separately compute the, for example, the sign of the result. So this is just multiplying 2 bits. Then we have to add the exponents, and we have to multiply the mantissas. And you know we have a normalized form which determines that we start with 0 point, and the first digit after the point is a non-zero. And then we have to normalize our result to this floating point format. And those are the basic steps. So these basic steps to which we split up a complex operation like a floating point multiply, they come from this data format. And each of these steps can be executed very efficiently on a processor, like adding the two exponents. It's an integer add. Can be done in one cycle. Multiplying the two mantissas is something like an integer multiply, can also be done with one cycle. So the idea of pipelining is to split up a complex operation into several simpler steps, and those steps are done for one instruction, one after each other, but each stage or each step of this pipeline can work on different operands. So we split up complex instruction into several simple steps, stages. Each stage takes the same amount of time. So in each stage, we have 5 cycles. For that reason, if you count the operations to be done for a floating point multiply, you will find that we get 5 of them. So we have 5 cycles of for performing a multiply operation. And important is that therefore different stages of this multiply pipeline can work at the same time on different operands. So that means we have in a 5-stage pipeline 5 instructions executed at the same time, but in different stages. I will show an example for that. If the pipeline is full and I have enough instructions waiting for it to be executed, I get 1 instruction done every cycle, because after each cycle, I get a new result. That means the throughput of this process or this concept is 1 instruction is done per cycle if the pipeline is filled. The drawback is, of course, the pipeline must be filled, so we have some startup times. The loop length should be much longer than the length of the pipeline to efficiently use this pipelining effect. And sometimes processors must reorder the instruction stream in our assembly code to make use of this pipelining. But I don't go into detail here, because on processors like Sandy Bridge, this is done at runtime by the out-of-order execution. This works very well. So this is the example for the pipelining of the multiply. Assume we want to multiply the contents of the 2 vectors B and C and write the results to the vector A, a simple loop. Here we have the 5 stages of our pipeline separate, so we have to separate. In the first step, we look what is the sign bit, what is the mantissa value, what is the exponent value for both operands. In the next step, we multiply the mantissas, then we add the exponents, we normalize the result to the floating point normal form, and then we insert the sign. So this would be typically a floating point multiply pipeline. And you can see, so as the first operand pair moves through the pipeline, then the second operand pair, the third, the fourth, and the fifth, and if we start the 5th calculation, all stages of the pipeline are occupied. What is a minimum requirement that you can use this pipeline, or what kind of code would immediately destroy this pipelining structure? Yes, if you put an if in, or you have a recursive data update. If your next input operand depends on the output of the previous iteration, because then you have to wait until this is done before you can start the next iteration. Yes. If it correctly predicts, but if the probability is 50% that one branch or the other branch is used, then pipelining will fail because he will mispredict. He can only choose one, and he needs to make an assumption. So who has ever used a pipeline? Where? No, in real world. In real world. In real life. But the question was, who has used a pipeline in real life? Exactly. So this is a pipeline. Or who has ever used the drive-in counter at McDonald's or Burger King? This is a pipeline. You order, you pay, you pick up your menu. three-stage pipeline. So McDonald's can serve three cars or customers at a time if there are enough customers available. Who has kids? Because if you have kids, you know what is the worst thing which could happen to a pipeline. I have four of them. You shouldn't start to order before everybody knows what he wants or she wants. Then you order a menu, you pay, and when you are about to pick up the menu, one kid decides he wants to change its menu. This is the worst thing. So we have just filled the pipeline, and then, like in a mispredicted branch, we were wrong. So everybody has to pull back. So with the cars behind are really happy if they have to pull back, you have to order once again and start everything again. So this is the worst thing what can happen to a pipeline. You are just about to complete, and then for some reason, we have to flush the pipeline. So remember this Burger King or McDonald's pipeline, and be fine. Or if you have a recursion, this is like the car behind you would stop and would only start ordering once you have tasted your meal and you tell him it's good, you can order. So the pipeline is empty. This is a recursion. So, okay. This was pipelining at the execution unit. Of course, we have also pipelining in the processor above, because just doing a floating point multiply is only a small part of the story. The corresponding instruction needs first to be loaded from the instruction cache. Then it will be decoded, and then it will be executed in the simplest case. So we have many steps before we execute this instruction. And also these steps are pipelined. So there's a pipeline above the floating point pipeline itself. So we fetch instruction 1 from the instruction cache in the first cycle, then we fetch instruction 2 in the next cycle, and we decode instruction 1. Then we fetch instruction 3, decode instruction 2, and execute instruction. So we have just talked about this step. So there's a higher level pipeline behind each instruction. So it needs to flow through the processor to the final execution unit. And here, this is especially a problem. If you look here, if the result of this instruction determines what is the next instruction. Like if some complex floating point arithmetics, then else. Then basically you have to wait here until this pipeline, the floating point pipeline, delivers the result before you fetch the next instruction. So branches are really a bad thing, especially if you have many options to branch to different code parts, and if they are unpredictable. Basically, in each loop, there is a branch. Who knows what kind of branch? In each loop, there is a branch, even if you don't use a if. Yes, the test, the condition. The test whether the current loop counter is equal to the loop length. There's always a branch, but this branch is always true or false, depending how you implement it. So this can be very well predicted. So the branch will be, the instruction will be issued, but the processor will continue the execution because it assumes that the branch goes in the right direction. And then if at the end of the loop, in the last iteration, you have the problem that you have to flush the pipeline, like in the McDonald's pipeline, because it went in the wrong direction. Okay. This is superscalarity. Of course, we not only have floating point multiply active at the same time, we can have a floating point add, we can have a floating point load, and a floating point store, and the multiply being active at the same time on the Sandy Bridge processor. So we have enough instruction issue ports and enough floating point and load store execution units to have those four instructions active at the same time. So modern Sandy Bridge processor is a four-way parallel processor core where we can run four instructions, load, store, multiply, and add at the same time. And basically, so then, if you look at this, we have this picture for all of those instructions. So you should have this in mind that we can execute multiple instructions at the same time if hardware is available in parallel for those. This is the idea of superscalability. If for some reasons your code is not able to use the hardware resources on the core level, SMT may help to increase the instruction throughput. So two simple examples would be, for example, this is if you run one thread, so no SMT, no simultaneous multithreading, then for the thread which is active and is blue here, marked blue, the thread has the complete memory hierarchy available for its own, especially registers and the control units. However, you can see the white boxes are unresourced stages in the pipelines, and we have here five different pipelines. For example, this pipeline is not at all used by your thread. Maybe your thread does only multiplies and never does an add. So there's an unused resource on the core. And here also, in these pipelines, we have some dependencies in the code executed by the threads which cause some empty bubbles, empty stages in the pipeline. And the idea of SMT is to spend some additional, only a few percentage of transistors on the processor, additional hardware units to execute two threads at the same time on the processor. And what is doubled, for example, is the register set, because the two threads must have their registers in the core at the same time to be able to do fast context switches between the threads. If we wouldn't have two register sets and we switch between two threads, first the register thread of thread 0 would have been written to level 1 cache, and we would need to load the content of register for thread 1 from the level 1 cache, and this takes dozens of cycles. So we need some hardware on the processors, like control structures and registers, which can host two or multiple threads. So with Intel, with two-way SMT, we have twice the register set.
That only helps if you have a very different workload.
Basically, you're right. But assume that you have a recursive update. A of I is A of I minus 1 times some scalar. Then you can only fill with one thread one stage of the pipeline. And four stages are empty. You agree? If you have a second thread doing the same, you can fill the second stage, because they are independent. And so if one thread only fills one, then the other one kicks in, at least fills the second one. Of course, you are true. For example, if one thread only does multiply and fills the complete multiply pipeline, then I wouldn't gain anything if a second thread also tries to get to the multiply pipeline, but a second thread could do the add. It depends. So this is one case, one thread cannot fill a given pipeline, then a second thread is helpful, or one thread does not fully, it does not use at all a given pipeline, then another thread can kick in. So, but very important is that we have support on the processor that on a cycle basis, execution can switch between the threads, because we need that to fill empty slots in those pipelines. So that means if I see that my bottleneck leaves space for using this pipeline by another thread, I can consider to use SMT. Okay, so this is probably one of the most important driving forces for performance of modern CPUs. It's the so-called SIMD instruction multiple data feature. Single instruction means that a single instruction operates concurrently on multiple operands. Remember our floating point pipeline? I tried to use only the term instruction. This floating point pipeline completes one instruction every cycle, if it's full. I didn't tell how many operands this instruction works on. So in a pipeline SIMD unit, each instruction works on multiple operands. For example, on the Sandy Bridge AVX process, with AVX instruction set, we get one, and we have fully pipelined the code, we get one instruction done per cycle, but four double precision floating point operations per cycle, because one instruction operates on multiple operands. So, with SSE, okay. And remember, the floating point units, they have to access the registers. They read data from register and write back data to register. If a single floating point instruction operates on four double precision elements at the same time, what should be the width of the registers? It's 256-bit, because one operand is 64-bit, and if I want to multiply two registers with four operands each register must hold 256-bit. And this is typically what gives you the SIMD width, the width of the register. So with SSE, the registers were 128-bit, and with AVX, the registers need to be 256-bit wide. So this is basically the picture. What is the difference between SIMD execution and pure so-called scalar execution? If a single instruction operates only on one operand, we call this scalar execution. While a SIMD instruction always operates on multiple operands. So this is a very simple pseudo-assembler code, and in scalar, there would be a scalar add the content of register 1, add the content of register 0 with the content of register 1, and write the result to register 2. If you have double precision, this operation instruction would only act on the lowest 64 bit of the register and completely ignore the other bit register, the remaining parts of the register. If you just change this instruction a bit, by telling use a vectorized instruction, and the width of the operand is 64-bit, almost the same instruction code now operates on four operands. The V means use the full register width. The 64 is important, because then the instruction knows I have four operands in the 256-bit register. And then it performs in parallel those four add operations. If I would write 32 here, then I would have eight operands here, and I would perform eight operations in parallel. So basically, your instruction code between a scalar and a vectorized execution, at least for a simple loop kernel, will look very similar. But you just have to replace the scalar instructions by vectorized instructions. So often the register usage is the same. So on this side, but only this, the term of the assembly instruction changes. And what I should also mention, who knows how many How many registers can be addressed here by the compiler? If the compiler generates code, he needs to know how many of those registers he can use. So how many registers are available in the x86 instruction set? So for a very simple code like that, adding two numbers and storing the result to another address, I need three registers. So how many registers are available for the compiler? 32. Another guess is? 16. Another guess is? 16. Yes, 16 is true. 16 is true. But the processor has many more registers, so-called shadow registers. Processor can switch at runtime between different register sets. But basically, in the instruction set architectures, there are only 16 registers available. And they are used both for scalar instructions, for SSE and AVX. So all those registers are aliased to the same physical register. In scalar execution, you only use the lowest 32 or 64 bit. In AVX execution, you use all 256 bit. But once you do scalar, you lose them. There's no way to use those resources if you use scalar execution. No other thread or something can use those resources. Okay. How does the...
Is SIMD only operating at instruction level? When you talk about SIMD, you're only talking about SIMD instructions.
So yes.
Whether
you use SIMD or not is determined at compile time.
Okay.
If the compiler doesn't use SIMD instructions, you will do scalar. It's not like in the pipelining. So if the out-of-order execution decides at runtime if there's that dependency or not. But here, if you do, here you will lose the battle at compile time. For that reason, it's always important to check assembly code or the compiler output whether the loop has been vectorized or not. Okay, so how does data travel from main memory through the caches to the registers? We have seen on the one figure that between the registers and the main memory, there are caches. And caches like intermediate storage. Typically, caches only hold a copy of the data from main memory. The original location for all data is always main memory. And in the caches are only copies of the data from main memory. So for that reason, we talk about travel and not moving data. Moving would mean you take the cache line from the memory and place it into a cache and remove it from the main memory. So data travels, and we only have copies of the data, of the original data, in the cache. Okay, and it's sufficient here if we look at a single cache line that keeps everything single cache level. Basically, if you go from level 3 to level 2, the same things happen. Okay. This should be clear to everyone. If I do a load address from this data, from main memory to the register, I just not get a single operand, 32 or 64 bit. I always get a full cache line. Data transfer from main memory to the cache and between the caches is always organized on full cache lines. I cannot load a single data item from main memory to the register. I always get a full cache line. I always get 64 bytes, even if I don't need the data. So data transfer is always organized in contiguous cache lines, and always complete cache lines are moved or are transferred between memories and the caches. The only point on the processor architecture where you can access single data items is from level 1 cache to the register. Only there you can load a single word, 128 bits or 256 bits. Below level 1 cache, all data transfers are on cache lines. This is important. So we have seen, we have register to register machine. So if I have a load, I send a request to the innermost cache. I want to have the data starting in this address. And then if the data is not in cache, the cache will say, I don't have the data, I need to grab it from main memory. And if data is not in cache, we call this as load miss data. We request data which is not in cache, so we have a miss. Once we have a miss, we need to load the data, the cache line to which this data belongs, to the cache and then to the register. We can also have store misses. When I want to store to address, a result to address, and the corresponding cache line is not in cache, I call a store miss. And then this happens what Georg told in the very first slide, a write allocate happens. Because I have a store miss on this cache line, first the cache line needs to be loaded to the cache, then I can modify the data in cache, and later on the data is evicted to the main memory. So let's see that on the example of a copy. So copy array C to array A, and assume that there are two cache lines of C and A in the main memory. And now I start load the first element, load C of 1. We have Fortran notation. I know in C we would have to load the address of C of 0. So if C of 1 is not in cache, we have a cache miss. And then the complete cache line is transferred to the cache, and in the next step, I get C of 1 from the cache to the register. Once I have C of 1, I want to store back to A of 1. So the cache line of A of 1 is in main memory, but not in cache. So we have a store miss. We need to first load the cache line to the cache. This is called a write allocate, and then we can change A of 1. And in the next 7, if the cache line is 8 elements, in the next 7 cycles, we can do the update in cache. And at some time later, when the cache is full and we need to replace data in cache, when this happens, then this cache line is written back to the main memory. So that means a cache can hold valid cache lines which have valid data while the content of the cache line in main memory is invalid. So at that time, this is the only valid copy of the cache line holding A of 1 while this one is invalid. This is old data. We have only modified here. And usually data is not directly written back to main memory. It's evicted later on. However, you can see the problem here. Our code tells us for one iteration, so A of 1 is C of 1, the code would say we need to load 8 bytes and to store back 8 bytes. So the total amount of data transfer in the code, if I make a model for the code, would be 16 bytes for a single iteration of my loop. However, at hardware, we see that we need 24 bytes. Load 8 bytes, store 8 bytes. So here, this is a good example where we need to understand the hardware because we have some data transfer in hardware which is not visible in the code. That means we have in our performance model to consider this additional data transfer to get a correct estimate what will be the performance of this loop structure. Okay. So this is also what Georg already told. Modern architectures are set up of multiple sockets. We call a single chip typically a socket. And they are connected through some proprietary hardware software layers. With Intel, it's QPI. On AMD, it's HyperTransport. And each socket has its own local physical memory. And by the use of this additional hardware software layer, we set up a single address space. Shared memory machine means that we have a single address space. On CC NUMA machines, this single address space can be the physical memory can be, the memory can be physically distributed, but we have a single address space. Okay, so this processor can address any data in this machine. The basic problem here is, at the end, where does my data finally end up? And this is the basic problem about CCNUMA. We will have a lecture. What are the basic mechanisms behind where is data allocated, when is data allocated, and in which physical memory, and how to keep data there where the processes or threads run which use this data. Okay, I skipped this slide about AMD. Basically, on AMD, Interlagos, for example, you have in a single socket two memory controllers. On AMD, on a so-called 16-core Interlagos processor, you have two chips, each one holding four modules, and has a separate memory interface. That means on AMD, you have a CCNUMA architecture within a single socket already. So this is comparable to one Sandy Bridge processor, to one of those here, for example. So because this fits into one socket on Intel, and this fits into one socket of your board on AMD. So you have already a CCNUMA structure within the socket. Can you imagine why AMD does this design, while Intel, for example, starts with this design? Basically, the performance you get from memory to the chips is the same here and here. It's easier to implement. When you put four DDR channels to a single memory controller, you need some kind of a complex switch. While here, you have two separate smaller switches. And it's always easier to reduce the amount of shared resources I am administrating. So this is much easier to implement on the hardware level, but it poses another pressure on you as a programmer. You have already at the single chip level to decide where data is. So you have more complexity in your machine. So these are just for this processor, how do I come to the peak performance number from this design? Who uses AMD processors? Who uses Intel processors? Who uses IBM processors, Blue Gene? Okay, so I skipped that. So this is now summarizing most of the things I have said so far. This is a single socket of a Sandy Bridge processor, 8 cores. Now, what are the driving forces for performance? In former times, when in the 80s and 90s, clock speed was the driving force. Clock speed doubled every 12 to 24 months. However, nowadays, the total floating point performance of such a chip is built up from four factors. Only one is the clock speed. This is the clock speed. Then we have, of course, the number of cores, because each core hosts separate floating point units. Then we have the superscalarity. Superscalarity means how many different instructions can I run at the same time. And on the Sandy Bridge processor, you can do one multiply and one add at the same time. So each processor gets two floating point instructions done per cycle. And then this is our SIMD, single instruction multiple data feature. Each instruction can do multiple operands. And the number of operands per instruction depends on the width of the SIMD register. If we assume AVX, like on the Sandy Bridge processor, we have 256-bit, so we get four double precision floating point operations done with a single instruction, or eight single precision. And so multiplying all those numbers, you can end up with this amazing performance numbers of roughly 200 gigaflops in double precision and 170 in double and 340 in single precision. This would have been number one in 1994 or 5 in the world. However, if you have a serial non-SIMD code, For both single and double precision, your performance is 5.4 gigaflops per second. So you can see you lose a factor of almost 70 if you run serial non-SIM decode as compared to the peak performance of the machine. And while this is for free, this using SIMD and parallelization, this is your task. This has to be performed by you to get access to these performance levels. Okay. So far, we have only looked inside the core, but you know that our modern architectures, like on the Cray machine, they have even more hard units incorporated, and the programming of your code to use all those features will be very complex and adds several programming paradigms or fuses several programming paradigms. So this is what we have done. We have SIMD vectorization at the core level. So by the way, who relies only on the compiler? Who hopes that the compiler will do the vectorization well when you do coding? So don't be shy. Yeah. Who uses compiler directives to force the compilers to do SIMD vectorization? Who has ever written code with SIMD intrinsics? Okay, good. Who has ever written assembly language code? Oh, with AVX? Okay, so you agree that, for example, if you use SIMD intrinsics, so we have another programming layer in here. Then on the socket, we have, for example, OpenMP to use the parallel shared resources here. Then we have to consider about data locality. So we need to make sure in our programming environment that data is allocated there, where it is used on later in the computation. But this is also an important factor if you use modern programming approaches, that you consider the CC-NUMA locality in your program. And then, of course, we have another level of memory, of additional memory hierarchy through the memory on the GPU. So we should also consider when we program GPU switch at adds another layer in the programming language, CUDA or OpenCL or something like that. And we also need to consider in our programming strategy that data transfer from between those memories also need to be minimized. So we have a lot of challenges when we set up a code, and each of those points can also be your hardware bottleneck if you don't consider them right. Okay, let's see. We have 5 minutes. So 5 minutes is enough to step in our lecture through the accelerators. So this is the basic view on Kepler processor GK110 design. This is an embarrassing. Basically, you can consider this as a many-core processor with wide SIMD units. So a single instruction here not applies to 4 operands, but to 192 single precision operands. This is a very similar picture. Even though you do a threading, and you can think of a CUDA block as a wide SIMD unit. So we have here 7 billion transistors, 15 of those SMX units, like big cores, with each one having a wide SIMD unit. So we have a high degree of parallelism in this machine. So we can do almost 3,000 single precision operations in a single cycle. So you, of course, have to provide this level of parallelism to the processor in your code. Unless the SIMD instruct execution, there's no 2x1 difference between single and double precision because they don't use the same hardware for single and double precision, but they have for every 3 single precision cores, 1 double precision unit. So in this case, we have a 3x1 difference between single and double precision because they just need separate double precision units and cannot use just 2 single precision units to do 1 double precision instruction. This is also the first architecture which have a reasonable on-chip cache and standard GDDR5 memory interface. This is the idea of the Intel Xeon Phi. Here we go back. So the basic idea of Intel Xeon Phi is use a simple processor design which only uses a very few transistors, but which carries a big gun. And the big gun is a wide SIMD unit. So on the Intel Xeon Phi, we have 60 processor cores on the processor chip, and each processor core carries 512-bit SIMD units. So that means the SIMD width as compared to AVX is doubled, so 512-bit. So with each SIMD unit, I can perform 8 double precision or 16 single precision floating point operations. In the same fashion as I explained, a single instruction triggers 8 double precision or 16 single precision operations, so the register width is 512-bit. We have each core has a dedicated level 1 cache and a segment of a shared L2 cache, so 512 kilobyte L2 cache, which is coherent across all cores. In total, this is 30 megabyte of level 2 cache, which sounds nice, but consider this level 2 cache only as a local segment of 512K for each processor core because it has a bad design. If this core wants a cache line from this, which is here, already here, then it gets the cache line through the ring bus, but it gets a copy of it. For example, if you have 60 threads on these processors, each thread using one core, and they all work on the same 512 kilobyte data set, the cache is full. Because each level 2 segment holds the same data. If new data comes in, you have to skip all those, the corresponding line in all other caches. So the best way to optimize for this machine is to consider that each core has a dedicated 512 kilobyte level 2 cache. Don't think that if you have a data structure which is 512 kilobyte and which is used by all threads, only consumes 512 kilobyte of level 2 cache because everybody gets a copy in its local segment. This is not true for the level 3 cache for the Sandy Bridge where there is one copy and everybody grabs this copy to its local cache. So there will always be a copy sent and placed in the local level 2 cache. And this is one of the big drawbacks here. So this is just a summary. Basically, both architectures gain their performance from the same idea, have multiple or as many floating point operations being executed in a single cycle as possible. So we have 60 cores and each one does 512-bit SIMD, so we have 480 or 960 double precision, single precision operations in a single cycle available, and here we have 1,000 double precision and almost 3,000 single precision operations in a single cycle. We have very low clock speeds on both sides. Power consumption is similar. Peak performance of the machines are similar in double precision. And main memory bandwidth is also, since they use the same technology, is also very similar. The number of threads you need to execute on this machine is typically up to 240. Who knows what is the processor architecture of the processor carrying the SIMD unit? This is an x86 compatible architecture, so you can use standard Intel compilers. Who knows? So this is one of the first Pentium designs. Oh, Georg, this is from 1994 or 1995. And it only requires 300,000 transistors for a single core. However, you don't have those nice features like out-of-order execution and all the hardware features which make programming of modern processors easy in terms of performance. So this is a completely in-order architecture. And to hide latencies of the execution units, you need to do multi-threading on this processor. So this processor supports four-way multi-threading. And typically we have seen you should use at least two threads per core. Because if data is close to the CPU and main memory bottleneck is not a bottleneck, you will run into one limitation of this processor. So this processor can only issue a thread on this processor can only issue an instruction every second cycle. So to be able to issue one instruction per cycle, you need to run two threads on this architecture. Okay, so this is a very, very simple design. And the advantage is that you can use standard programming languages. This is x86 compatible. You have a SIMD vectorized code and you are done. But SIMD vectorization is minimum requirement. Even if you use all 60 cores without SIMD, they will never get to the performance level of a single modern core. So without SIMD vectorization, don't use this machine. And here you use OpenCL or CUDA or OpenACC, but the number of threads, of course, you need to generate is much higher because here much of the parallelism is hidden in the SIMD instruction set, and here you have to generate at least one thread per execution unit. And since they are pipelined and there is no out-of-order execution on those chips, you need multiple threads per execution unit to hide the latency. So typically, you have to issue ten thousands of threads. So this should be the last slide before the break. Well, nowadays it's accepted that, widely accepted, that the GPU, if you do a comparison on a fair basis, does not achieve a speed up of 50 or higher as compared to a CPU. So for several years, there were lots of papers claiming that they achieved 20, 50, 100, 200x speed up on a GPU versus a CPU. However, if you do performance modeling, you look at the hardware, you know about bottlenecks, you are immediately aware that you can only achieve a maximum speed up on your code, which is the maximum difference in hardware performance of the bottleneck you hit on both architectures. So if your bottleneck is main memory bandwidth, you just need to compare the available main memory bandwidth on the CPU node and on the GPU. And this is some recent number for Xeon. For a single server Sandy Bridge node, the main memory bandwidth is 80 gigabytes per second. The main memory bandwidth with ECC on the Kepler is something like 170 gigabytes per second. So if main memory bandwidth is your limitation, you should get a speed up of maximum of 2. Because your bottleneck doesn't give a higher speed up in hardware. If you get a higher speed up, this is for a physicist, like if you would measure a velocity higher than light speed. So for that reason, we call this light speed estimate. So we compare typical bottlenecks for modern cores codes like compute bound and main memory bandwidth with respect to the capabilities at hardware. And so typically, if you compare a server or a compute node on CPU basis with a latest NVIDIA card, you can get a speed up of 2, maybe depending which CPU architecture you compare, maybe 3 or 4. And if you compare peak performance, you can get a speed up of 2 to at maximum 10 if you do single precision computation. So whenever a number higher than that is shown, I can go back to my first slide. This is because then you compare with the wrong baseline, with a bad baseline. Of course, you can gain any speed up, GPU versus CPU, if you have a highly optimized GPU code and you compare with a serial non-optimized CPU code. And this is what people usually did. So, but on a fair comparison, and if you do compare highly optimized implementations, you will see a speed up of 2 to 3. Okay, so we do the break here.